Welcome to this installation of Think About Energy. As we had mentioned to you, this year, 2021, we're doing some new things. We're having some conversations around energy. Our goal is to really give you the opportunity to be educated and informed about changes happening in Harrisburg, Columbus, Washington, D.C. And my goodness, the changes are happening. So we have to educate ourselves. We have to get familiar with what's going on. And really, today is a wonderful opportunity to be looking at not only 2021, but something that may have snuck in 2020. And we're blessed to have Marty Durbin join us today because as the president of the Global Energy Institute, he's keenly aware of the Energy Act of 2020. This is an act that got enacted in December, but it got in there. And what we're going to hear about is how it got in there on bipartisanship and how it really affects energy and where we're going forward. So once again, we're blessed to have Marty. Marty, I can't thank you enough for joining us today. You know, it's a pleasure to catch up with you. You know, I'm reading an article in the Hill magazine or Hill publication, and I saw, you know, this effort that you're talking about. And what struck me was not only the bipartisan nature of what's going on in D.C., but the fact, as you pointed out, this is something that's hiding in plain sight. And I thought, you know what, this is something that our viewers need to get an understanding of. So welcome to the podcast. Welcome to this opportunity for you to share with us. And with that said, Marty, walk me through what you see happening in Washington, D.C. in December and here into 2021.
Great. Well, George, first, let me thank you for the invitation to be here. And it's really great to see you again and to be working with you again. But no, to your point, everyone's seen that climate has taken on a much more visible role. And the Biden administration has certainly set out some very ambitious goals. And we expect to hear more next month at the climate summit. But what I wanted to make sure is that people understood the enormous progress that was made at the end of last year, as you pointed out, and as my article in The Hill points out, and gives us something to really point to as a model for how we can move legislation forward. First of all, I would tell you that the Energy Act of 2020, together with a separate bill that was paired that's actually going to phase out the production and use of HFCs, another powerful greenhouse gas. The Chamber of Commerce played a lead role in driving both of those bills forward. If it hadn't been caught up in all of that end of year appropriations and COVID relief and all the rest, we would have been lauding it as probably the most important climate and energy related legislation we've seen in decades come out of Congress. Really important is in addition to the policy progress that was made here, was the fact that Congress used some muscles it hasn't used in a while. It took this bill through regular order. You know, I've gone out of my way to applaud, at the time, the chairman of the Energy Committee, Lisa Murkowski from Alaska, and the ranking member at the time, Joe Manchin from West Virginia. I thought they were really masterful in the way that they spent 2 years, and with our help and the help of many others in not only the business community, but we had coalition of environmental groups, think tanks, labor unions, and others that all said, this is important. We need to get some significant climate and energy innovation legislation enacted. What the two senators did was to say, they held all kinds of hearings on a lot of different bills covering everything from renewable energy to carbon capture and sequestration and carbon removal. Advanced nuclear, grid storage, battery storage, all the different technologies that we're going to need to address climate change in the long term. Every one of those bills had bipartisan supporters, and they were sponsored in bipartisan ways, brought them through the committee, then combined it all into one bill and took it to the floor. I mean, that's the kind of thing we used to see all the time. We don't see as much of it anymore, but it's really important for us to recognize that that's a model that can be followed now going forward, even with a 50-50 Senate and a very narrow margin in the House. And I don't want to dismiss the fact that, the House as well, that Energy and Commerce Committee, the Science Committee, and other committees also worked on this bill in a bipartisan fashion. And so we take great pride in being able to say that we helped get this done. We took a leadership role as the Chamber of Commerce, again, together with this broad and diverse coalition. But now we've really got to focus on, you know, what's next. Great that we now have a lot more money going into research and development on these critical technologies. But first, we've got to make sure that they actually get funded, you know, that the appropriations process, you know, gives the money to them and that they get managed well. And much more importantly, it's one thing to do the research. What are we going to do to facilitate the business community, who we know at the end of the day are going to be the ones that are going to have to finance, develop, build, commercialize, and deploy these technologies at scale and affordably so that we can reduce emissions, not only here in the U.S., but around the world. So that's going to why we focused as much as we did on this particular issue, that particular bill, and how we really think it's a model for now how we can and should move forward on climate policy.
And when you think about it, back to your point, you know, when I read, you know, Senator Manchin's comments and Senator Murkowski's comments, they talked about, you know, they were hailing this as massive legislation that hasn't passed like this in the last decade. And again, to your point, there was a lot going on at the time, but when you think about it, it's $35 billion dedicated towards research and development. At the end of the day, what do we have to do to get that mobilized? I think that's the piece that I'm most interested as we move forward to think about the idea that this needs to be deployed, not just talked about. So give us your insights there, sir.
Yeah, you know, there's a couple of things. As I noted, one thing we have to do is now go through the congressional appropriations process and make sure that all that money that was authorized to be spent through the Department of Energy and elsewhere actually is allocated to those agencies, and we can start to see that research being done. Secondly, we've got to work on mechanisms that will facilitate facilitate capital from the private sector going into, you know, so whether it's green financing of various ways or tax policy or other incentives, let's say, yeah, not only do we need to show that we can do it in a lab, but we've got to get, you know, make sure that we can demonstrate that it can be deployed and actually, you know, have the impact we need it to have. The other fact here is that, you know, as Congress is going to start working on its climate policy. In the House, they introduced a bill last week, the Clean Futures Act. Good news for me is that while there's a lot of things in there we like, there are some things in there we don't like, but the committee is very clearly going to take a deliberate process. They're going to go through regular order and hold hearings, and we really want to be able to engage with them and show what are the types of policies we think would be effective. From the chamber standpoint, we would much rather see market-based approaches, you know, to climate policy than to simply have regulations or mandates. We've also got an administration, as I mentioned, and I'm sure everyone knows, has come in, you know, day one, an executive order on climate policy. They've already said that, you know, that we've got a climate summit coming up next month on the 22nd of April. We expect them to announce new global commitments, or I'm sorry, U.S. commitments to the Paris Accords. You know, speaking for the chamber, we applauded President Biden rejoining the Paris Accord. We think it was, you know, necessary for the U.S. to be there from a global leadership standpoint, but also to, you know, defend our national interests, as well as promote the opportunity for U.S. business, you know, to continue to be technology leaders and develop the technology that is going to be deployed around the world. As even Secretary Kerry has pointed out, 90% of the emissions are coming from outside of the United States. Almost, it's about 86%. But the fact is, even if we go to zero, emissions will continue to grow because of the developments elsewhere. So that's not to say, you know, wring our hands and say, therefore, there's nothing we can do. It's no, let's recognize it's a global challenge. The developing world is not going to say, well, we won't develop energy resources or we won't develop our economies. So it's almost incumbent on us to help develop and deploy technologies at a scalable and affordable level. The technology may be great, but if the developing country isn't going to deploy it, it doesn't do anything. So we are working closely with the administration. My guess is when they announce the new goals, they're going to be quite ambitious and maybe something that we would say, Not sure you're going to be able to reach that goal in that amount of time. But we don't want to shy away from the idea of having ambition. And also just to understand that, you know, let's make clear, I don't know what the technology advances are going to be or how quickly they will come. You'll understand this, George. I frequently, in this context, cite the developments of hydraulic fracturing and horizontal drilling as something that nobody saw coming, certainly not as quickly as it did or as effectively as it did.
Correct.
And that one development did more to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in the United States than anything else. So I'm humble enough to say, you know, that was a disruptive technology in the power generation space, for example. Something else can come along 5 years from now. Maybe we see a huge leap in technology, whether it's on battery storage or advanced nuclear or, you know, you name it. And so I think that's what we need to be prepared to say. There are solutions. We all agree on what we want the outcome to be, reducing emissions as quickly as we can. But let's focus on making sure we have the right policies in place that are going to leverage the ability of the business community to develop, deploy, and commercialize these technologies.
And I think that's what has me so impressed, because, you know, it's the coalition that got behind the effort that you're talking about from all the different industries. But what impresses me is, you know, knowing you and knowing that you're working at the Global Energy Institute, but that's part of the U.S. Chamber. And when you think about it, your members are innovating, they're technology driven. And it's so critical that we don't just create, as you said, a mandate that hangs out there, that we actually have the development of the technology. And that's one thing that hydraulic fracturing and other things, electric cars, we're leading on. Mm-hmm. So to take that leadership role in the US, to not just say, we're gonna have this number that it's out there, not only that, we're going to have the technology to get us to that number. And number two, when other countries are looking, they should be looking to us. So do I read that correctly, that that's why someone like yourself at the chamber would stand so strongly behind this bill?
Yes. And I think the other important point is that, you know, and as I pointed out in the article as well, I refer to it as a kitchen sink approach, but we can't say that we know which technology is going to be the answer yet, or to give undue, I will say, preferential treatment to one fuel source, one technology, what have you. We don't know which of these are going to pan out and be affordable, you know, and achievable and realistic. So let's work on all of them. We'll figure it out all the way. And frankly, this is, you know, I'm sure many of you have read Bill Gates' recent book. I happen to agree, at least on this point, that, you know, the three things we need here are technology, policy that helps to develop that, and the market that's now going to, you know, allow the market to drive the use of the technologies that we're going to need to meet that overall outcome we all agree on.
And when you think about that market, and again, developing it, you want to do it in an entrepreneurial way. You don't want to be told this is the way to get there. You know, tell me, back to your point, I always talk about it with my own children. Look, you know, the speed limit's X, 55, 65, 70, but allow me to get there in my own car. But I know what the limit is. I will get there. Set out those standards. Mm-hmm. And to the point, whether it's on nuclear side, whether it's energy storage, whether it's on renewables, natural gas, whatever those are, we all have an opportunity to play into this. And again, it's fascinating because it occurred in 2020. The major piece of this happens. Here we are, new administration, new vision, but we have to be engaged. And one of the things that we constantly try to do on episodes like this is really have people think about the energy, where it comes from, what goes into it. This piece, to me, is over the horizon. Yeah. And to your point of kitchen sink, I think the more folks know you need that diversified portfolio of solutions, the better. So in a sense of closing, I'm sorry, you had another thought, Marty?
No, I was just going to say, I think there's no question that, you know, we're going to see a lot of activity around climate. You know, the administration's taking, you know, a whole of government view. Every agency is going to have a piece of this. And that's all fine. I'm not predicting that we're going to have some major comprehensive climate legislation that will move through this year. But I do think there's no question that the infrastructure package that's going to be coming out, you know, very soon will have some significant climate related, you know, titles to it. It did last year. We're expecting more this year, whether that's incentives for EV charging stations, more energy efficiency, lots of different things that they've that they're floating around here. And that's all fine. But again, we don't want to lose sight of, you know, we made significant progress with that Energy Act. Let's not lose the momentum, and let's make sure that you know, we now push that forward through funding and facilitating you know, the development and deployment.
And I agree with you. It's build upon that massive success that happened in December. Let's work to make certain it gets funded. And more importantly, let's make certain that folks don't overlook what did occur and build upon that. Because again, a lot of the same folks are still out there, whether it's, you know, Senator Murkowski or Joe Manchin. I mean, they need to be applauded, as you mentioned. They ought to be thanked. So again, that's one of the things that we're constantly trying to do, is make certain that people are aware what's going on and everything they can do to take action. And sometimes that action is a thank you. So we want to make certain that past actions for 2020 get thanked. But at the same time, when they're working on it, here we are 2021, and we're going to be working to get these things funded. And when people think about the opportunity, it's all of the above energy choices. So when you talk about throwing in the kitchen sink, it's clearly identified that there are several ways to get to those reduction limits, but let's not just pick one. Let's pick them all, figure out which one's sustainable and developable and can be done on scale, and move towards it. So I appreciate you coming in and sort of walking us through what has happened, where we stand now. Give me one more opportunity as to what you think is our next steps, Marty, as we proceed into 2021.
Well, I think it, and I'm gonna go a little bit higher level here, and it, what I think is going to be very important. You know, we've just come off of passage of the American Rescue Plan that only had votes from one party. Right? So there's a lot of people thinking, gee, we'll never be able to get anything done. Don't forget what they were able to accomplish in a bipartisan manner with the American Energy Act. We can do it again. There are people here in Washington, D.C. There is a governing coalition with a focus on governing that wants to get things done, and they need to be rewarded for that. They need to be encouraged to do that. I know the Chamber of Commerce is very clearly leaning into that for a whole variety of issues, but it's going to be critical on this as well. And I think we can get there. So I appreciate and really appreciate the opportunity to, you know, to be here and to join you, George.
I appreciate you taking the time out. I know that one thing we always want to do is make certain people know how to contact you and where you're at and the opportunity for getting more information. So again, I know from your standpoint, the Global Energy Institute is one of those places. We want to make certain that we're arming our supporters with solid, good, current information. So we would encourage them to go there. I know we did what we could on your efforts to follow you, because it's that opportunity. You're talking about things. And that's when I realized, oh my goodness, there was this Hill article, and I'll quote it if they haven't had an opportunity. It was from February 18th, 2020, was the Hill article that you authored on the climate opportunity hiding in plain sight. If you need to, take the opportunity, pull that up on your iPhone, look through it, see what we're talking about here. That's the basis. There's really neat pieces in there. It is about the bipartisan nature of what can be done. The more we get folks to focus on that and appreciate that, we'll be better off. And again, Marty, I can't thank you enough for taking time out. And it's my hope that we'll get the opportunity to see you further on Think About Energy webinars like this and podcasts. Your insights are wonderful. You're bringing us a view from DC we're not getting, and we want to make certain that we're tuned in to what you see that's out there. So any closing thoughts on your end, sir?
No, I'd be happy to join in for further conversations. And again, really appreciate the opportunity to be here.
All righty. Thank you, sir.